In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
I will go unto the altar of God.
Give an altar, my joy and gladness.
Our help is in the name of the Lord. Let us proceed in peace.
In the name of Christ.
Amen.
Thank you. Spirit, the whole body of thy faithful people is governed and sanctified. Hear our prayer which we offer for all members of thy holy church, that in their vocation and ministry they may serve thee in holiness and truth to the glory of thy name. Through Jesus Christ, our Saviour, Jesus Christ, our Lord, who liveth and reigneth with thee in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, world without end.
A reading from the Acts of the Apostles. Paul made this defense before King Agrippa. I myself was convinced that I ought to do many things against the name of Jesus of Nazareth, and that is what I did in Jerusalem. With authority received from the chief priests, I not only locked up many of the saints in prison, but I also cast my vote against them when they were being condemned to death. By punishing them often in all the synagogues, I tried to force them to blaspheme. And since I was so furiously enraged at them, I pursued them even to foreign cities. With this in mind, I was traveling to Damascus with the authority and commission of the chief priests when at midday along the road, Your Excellency, I saw a light from heaven, brighter than the sun, shining around me and my companions. When we had all fallen to the ground, I heard a voice saying to me in the Hebrew language, "Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me? It hurt you to kick against the goats." I asked, "Who are you, Lord?" The Lord answered, "I am Jesus whom you are persecuting. But get up and stand on your feet, for I have appeared to you for this purpose, to appoint you to serve and testify to the things in which you have seen me and to those in which I will appear to you. I will rescue you from your people and from the Gentiles, to whom I am sending you to open their eyes so that they may return from darkness to light and from the power of Satan to God, so that they may receive forgiveness of sins and a place among those who are sanctified by faith in me." After that, King Agrippa, I was not disobedient to the heavenly vision, but declared first to those in Damascus, then in Jerusalem, and throughout the countryside of Judea, and also to the Gentiles, that they may repent and turn to God, and do deeds consistent with repentance. For this reason, the Jews seized me in the temple and tried to kill me. To this day, I have had help from God, and so I stand here, testifying to both small and great, saying nothing but what the prophets and Moses said would take place, that the Messiah must suffer, and that by being the first to rise from the dead, he will proclaim light both to our people and to the Gentiles. The word of the Lord.
Galatians. I want you to know, brothers and sisters, that the gospel that was proclaimed by me is not of human origin. For I did not receive it from a human source, nor was I taught it, but I received it through a revelation of Jesus Christ. You have heard, no doubt, of my earlier life in Judaism. I was violently persecuting the Church of God and was trying to destroy it. I advanced in Judaism beyond many among my people of the same age, for I was far more zealous for the traditions of my ancestors. But when God, who had sent me apart before I was born and called me through his grace, was pleased to reveal his Son to me, that I might proclaim him among the Gentiles, I did not confer with any human being, nor did I go up to Jerusalem to those who were already apostles before me. But I went away at once into Arabia, and afterwards I returned to Damascus. Then, after 3 years, I did go up to Jerusalem to visit Cephas and stayed with him for 15 days. But I did not see any other apostle except James, the Lord's brother. In what I am writing to you before God, I do not lie. Then I went into the regions of Syria in Cilicia, and I was still unknown by sight to the churches of Judea that are in Christ. They only heard it said, "The one who formerly was persecuting us is now proclaiming the faith he once tried to destroy." And they glorified God because of me. The word of the Lord.
Thank you. The Lord be with you.
And with thy spirit.
Let us attend the Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Matthew. Peter said to Jesus, "Look, we have left everything and followed you. What then will we have?" Jesus said to them, "Truly I tell you, at the renewal of all things, when the Son of Man is seated on the throne of his glory, you who have followed me will also sit on 12 thrones, judging the 12 tribes of Israel. And everyone who has left houses or brothers or sisters or father or mother or children or fields for my name's sake will receive 100-fold and will inherit eternal life. But many who are first will be last, and the last will be first." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise be to you, O Christ.
May I speak in the name of God, source of all being, eternal word, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Well, it's good to be here, and it's good to welcome online worshippers from across Scotland and beyond as we remember the life of that great saint, Saint Paul, whose conversion we celebrated on Thursday, when we also celebrated our Scottish bard, Robbie Burns. And we celebrate St. Paul in a church dedicated to St. Paul, Old St. Paul's, Edinburgh. I won't enlarge on the history of this congregation because most people here this morning know that history better than I do. But for those watching who may not be so familiar with Old St. Paul's in Edinburgh, suffice to say that this church, from the moment that the first congregation, the Episcopal congregation, left St. Giles to gather in a wool store, this congregation has long been noted for its strong and abiding presence in Edinburgh's old town, ministering to people and situations often beneath Edinburgh's respectable veneer, where there is often profound and intractable need. A church noted too, I should say, and I would say this is relevant to my previous point, noted for its glorious liturgy, which with its dance and theatre, its colour and music, invites worshippers into a transformative and intimate encounter with Christ and with one another in the sacrament of bread and wine. It makes me smile, therefore, to think that this place, which speaks at its core of the timeless universality, the Catholicity of the Christian Church, should be dedicated to St. Paul, who has often been claimed as hero and inspiration for those parts of our tradition that might be described as reformed or Protestant. Whether St. Paul himself would be content with any such labels must be open to doubt. Would he recognize himself in the enthusiasms of his devotees? It's a similar question to, was Jesus a Christian? Would either Jesus or Paul be 100% satisfied with what we've done with their teachings? I suspect that those who claim to be their followers, including you and me, grasp only a tiny proportion of what they were saying, and sometimes, as we know only too well and painfully, sometimes end up getting entirely the wrong end of the stick. What we do know about St. Paul, and it's brought to the fore at this feast of his conversion, what we know about him, because he tells us himself, and his contemporaries also tell us, is that he was a nasty piece of work. He had been a very unpleasant man, persecuting people because of their beliefs, wrecking lives in a personal vendetta against the followers of Jesus. As I heard a speaker say recently, people can always find good reasons to do bad things. In his pursuit of goodness, in his conviction that he was right, in his fanaticism, Paul was absolutely convinced, before he had that conversion experience, that he was on the side of the angels. I suppose human beings have always been skilled at justifying to themselves what appears to most other people to be wrong or even evil, and then to criticize their opponents as somehow lacking in moral compass. Indeed, for some reason, our present day is very big on self-righteousness and small on forgiveness, eager to mistake self-interest for the moral high ground, not interested in exploring the shades and nuances of truth, but clinging desperately to the need to be right. Good reasons to do bad things. Writ large, as we see all too obviously every day, writ large, this mentality can have dire, destructive, and cataclysmic consequences. We see it all around us, we see it throughout history, just as we see it in Paul's treatment of those first Christians. What we also learn from Paul, however, is that this nastiness came to an abrupt end. On the road to Damascus, he met Jesus, or perhaps more appropriately, he collided with Jesus. And in a moment of intense self-understanding, his good reasons for doing bad things all evaporated. And he saw, having been deprived of his physical sight, he saw all the more clearly how monstrous his behavior had been. That not only had he been hurting others, he had in fact been hurting himself too. The conversion of St. Paul then is a celebration of hope. The first moments, if you like, of a slow process of resurrection, of the death of one thing and the birth of another, connected to what was and yet utterly different too. Paul, as we heard in the readings, recognizes very clearly who he was. He acknowledges the terrible impact his actions have had on others. Yet he discovers that despite all this, he is also wholly loved and accepted by God. not because of anything he's done, but because of who God is. This is what makes St. Paul not an apostle of duty and hard work, not of an apostle of orthodoxy, but the apostle of grace, of God's grace. That we're saved not because we do all the right things, but that we want to do all the right things because we're saved. Because by the grace of God we glimpse and know ourselves to be embraced by the love of God. This is why St. Paul puts aside the laws and rules he has grown up with and followed so zealously and fanatically, and replaces them with one rule only, the rule of love, to love as God loves. The conversion of St. Paul teaches us about hope, about grace, and about God. And above all, it teaches us what resurrection might mean. As Carl Jung said, resurrection is not restoration of what was, nor is it recovery of a predetermined state of health, nor for that matter is it reformation on the basis of long ago established fundamental norms. Resurrection is something new. It challenges us, it perplexes us, it disturbs us. And as St. Paul discovered, it can put us at odds with those, even those, who share our faith. St. Paul's first steps towards resurrection encourage us, and they should inspire us too, not to yearn for a past golden age, or to fixate on a new set of rules for church order that somehow will save us, but to open our minds, to trust in a God who walks beside us now as God has walked beside us in the past and will walk beside us in the future. And in exploring the teaching of Jesus and Paul, seek out what new things they might wish to tell us. Amen.
In peace, let us pray to the Lord.
Of all the earth, we pray for people suffering because of the world's troubles. We pray for those traumatized by war. We pray for the hostages imprisoned in Gaza, for those who have died, for the innocents in Gaza. May hearts be turned by your grace from hate to the ways of peace. Give wisdom to leaders and authorities, especially in our own land and in this city. Lord, in your mercy, we pray for all who are sick, who suffer pain. Lord, we lift in prayer all who are homeless. May they have solutions for their plight and be given hope. We pray for those who have asked for prayer. Sheila Rimmer, Alex Lunn, Maria, Sophie Challoner, David Taylor, Emily Kyles, Leslie King, Amy Mulcair, Ron Allen. Lord, in your mercy, we pray for Bishop John and the College of Bishops, and for all who serve in this church. Endue them with faith and strength. We pray for all congregations in this city, for the Anglican Communion worldwide, and for all believers throughout the world, especially those who are persecuted for the name of Christ. Lord, in your mercy, we pray for those who have died recently, remembering Glenn Carney, Diana Bubb, Kathleen Cummins, Sarah Gascoigne, and for the departed whose year's mind falls this week, Elizabeth Temple, Paul Martin, Jane Beaton, Vivian Wiley, John Dale. May they rest in peace. We pray for ourselves, for discernment and the ability to know truth in these confusing times. We pray for the mercy that comes from the Lord Jesus Christ towards us and to all whom we love. Lord, in your mercy.
Living God, in Christ, you make all things new. Transform the poverty of our nature by the riches of your grace. And in the renewal of our lives, make known your glory through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. We meet in Christ's name. Let us share his peace.
Good morning, everybody, and a very warm welcome to Old St. Paul's. A very special welcome to Bishop John and to Claire. It's lovely to have you with us, and a great blessing to have you among us on this, our Feast of Title. Welcome also if you're visiting, and as Bishop John said earlier, welcome also to those who are joining online, both our regulars and also others who are joining from the Episcopal Church's live stream service today. It's great to have you with us. Please do come and join us afterwards for lunch in the hall. There'll be plenty of food, so even if you hadn't planned on staying, I'm sure there'll be more than enough food for everybody. So please do come and join us after Mass for food in the hall. There are a couple of notices on your sheet just to bring your attention to. The first is an event for our younger adult members hosted by Mother Jamie on Tuesday. And the other is, in a couple of weeks' time, of course, it's Shrove Tuesday, so we have a social event in the hall on that day. So please do take note of those events. And finally, we have a birthday, a rather special one, of a rather special person. Many of you were here last night downstairs enjoying and sharing in Sheila Brock's 90th birthday. I'm allowed to say that, yes. Sheila, you are not only one of the longest standing members of this congregation, but also one who continues to bring your love, your care, your commitment to this place, your wisdom, your memory of so much of what we've done in the past, but also continually fresh energy into the life of this congregation. We deeply love and respect you. We love having you as part of this community. And I've got a little something just to say happy birthday before we... I think we may not be having you downstairs, so we might need to sing happy birthday now. Just give me a moment. We couldn't not give you something. So here's some flowers as a token of our love and our appreciation of you on your birthday.
Well,
happy birthday, Sheila.
Thank you.
Happy birthday to you.
Let us now present our offerings to the Lord with reverence and godly fear.
Oh.
Heavenly Father, you bless the gifts of bread and wine we set before you. Bless also the gift of our hearts and minds as we offer our lives in your service through Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And with thy spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up unto the Lord.
Let us give thanks unto our Lord God.
It is meet and right so to do.
It is very meet, right, and our bounden duty that we should at all times and in all places give thanks unto thee, O Lord, Holy Father, almighty, everlasting God, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who didst vouchsafe to choose thy servant Saint Paul to be of the company of the apostles, by whose ministry thine elect might be gathered in from every nation, and thy church instructed in the way that leadeth unto everlasting life. Therefore, with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify thy glorious name, evermore praising thee and saying,
Oh.
All glory and thanksgiving be to thee, Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, for that thou of thy tender mercy didst give thine only Son, Jesus Christ, to suffer death upon the cross for our redemption, who by his own oblation of himself once offered, made a full, perfect, and sufficient sacrifice, oblation, and satisfaction for the sins of the whole world, and did institute, and in his holy gospel command us to continue, a perpetual memorial of that his precious death and sacrifice until his coming again. For in the night that he was betrayed, he took bread, and when he had given thanks, he brake it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, Take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. Likewise, after supper, he took the cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, Drink ye all of this, for this is my blood of the New Testament, which is shed for you and for many, for the remission of sins. Do this as oft as ye shall drink it, in remembrance of me.
Wherefore, O Lord and Heavenly Father, according to the institution of thy dearly beloved Son, our Saviour Jesus Christ, we thy humble servants do celebrate and make here before thy divine majesty, with these thy holy gifts which we now offer unto thee, the memorial thy Son hath commanded us to make.
Having in remembrance his blessed passion and precious death, his mighty resurrection and glorious ascension, rendering unto thee most hearty thanks for the innumerable benefits procured unto us by the same, and looking for his coming again with power and great glory.
And we, thine unworthy servants, beseech thee most mercifully, Father, to hear us, and to send thy Holy Spirit upon us, and upon these gifts and creatures of bread and wine, that being blessed and hallowed by his life-giving power, they may become the body and blood of thy most dearly beloved Son, to the end that all who receive his name may be sanctified both in body and soul, and preserved unto everlasting life.
And we earnestly desire thy fatherly goodness, mercifully to accept this, our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving.
And here we humbly offer and present unto thee, O Lord, ourselves, our souls and bodies, to be a reasonable, holy, and living sacrifice unto thee, beseeching thee to accept this our bounden duty and service, not weighing our merits, but pardoning our offences, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
By whom and with whom, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honour and glory be unto thee, O Father Almighty, world without end.
Amen.
As our Saviour Christ hath commanded and taught us, we are bold to say,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever.
Deliver us, Lord, from every evil, and grant us peace in our day. In your mercy, keep us free from sin, and protect us from all anxiety, as we wait in joyful hope for the coming of our Saviour, Jesus Christ, who is Lord for ever and ever.
Amen.
We break this bread to share in the body of Christ.
Though we are many, we are one body, for we all share in one bread.
We do not presume to come to this thy holy table, O merciful Lord, trusting in our own righteousness, but in thy manifold and great mercies. We are not worthy so much as to gather up the crumbs under thy table, but thou art the same Lord, whose nature is always to have mercy. Grant us therefore, gracious Lord, so to eat the flesh of thy dear Son, Jesus Christ, and to drink his blood, that our sinful bodies may be made clean by his most sacred body, and our souls washed through his most precious blood, and that we may evermore dwell in him, and he in us. Amen. The gifts of God for the people of God.
Jesus Christ is holy. Jesus Christ is Lord. To the glory of God the Father. Amen.
Give thanks to the Lord, for he is gracious.
And his mercy endures forever.
Father, we have broken the bread which is Christ's body. We have tasted the wine of his new life. We thank you for these gifts by which we are made one in him and drawn into that new creation which is your will for all. Through him who died for us and rose again, your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen. Blessed be the name of the Lord.
Now and forever.
Our help is in the name of the Lord.
Who has made heaven and earth.
God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, give you the spirit of wisdom and revelation to know the hope to which he has called you.
Amen.
God, who has shown you a pattern of holy living and holy dying in the lives of the saints, bring you to share their glorious inheritance.
Amen.
God, who calls you no longer strangers, but fellow citizens with the saints, set your hearts and minds on things above, where Christ is seated at God's right hand.
Amen.
And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be amongst you and remain with you always.
Amen.
Go in peace to love and serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.